Good afternoon all. You can see the subject I'm planning to talk about. I hope I stick to the subject. Doing rocket science. It is actually rocket science, but I must point out at this stage that for the average satellite tracker in our group, you do not have to be a rocket scientist. It just depends on which area you want to play around. If you want to play with predicting where a newly launched satellite may land or land up in orbit, then you need to do rocket science, because you're working with rockets, trajectories, booster rockets, and things like that. So, I don't do much rocket science as such. I am now basically an observer and an experimenter. I have a very limited budget. I'm on a pension. I'm paid by the NRF, and they don't pay well. I live in the worst possible, like one of the worst possible observing locations. I'm surrounded by light pollution, surrounded by freeways, and I've got the, I won't use a word I can use, but the worst possible scene. Never better than 12 arc seconds. I live in Pines, just across the river. I have wind currents coming from that way, wind currents coming up the valley. They meet above my house. The clouds form there, exactly where I want to observe. The rest of the sky is clear. Then I use as much as possible as in my junk box. That means you have to be a junk collector. Those that know me know that I salvage anything that has a vague possibility of being used. And this, I think, applies to most amateur telescope makers. You never know what's going to be useful. For example, we saw a washing machine being used. I've used bits out of sewing machines, teletypes. I've even used stuff that the observatory threw out. Incidentally, I was a professional astronomer, but I was tracking satellites long before I became a professional, and I hope to carry on tracking long after I ceased to be a professional. My bosses in the observatory, they weren't too impressed with my performance, because astronomy was just a means of earning an income to pay for my main interest. So I can say that now, but not then. I'm by nature extremely lazy. That's why I've got the shape of it. And I don't have much patience, especially with myself. And then am I sane? Why do I subject myself to spending a fair portion of my remaining life sitting in a dark room, looking at a computer, looking at clouds? But it's fun and rewarding. That's why I do it. Right, why do I do it? Or why do we observe it? By we, I'm not referring to the royal we. My wife's not interested. But I'm referring to the group that is involved in this activity. The Earth, as most of you know, is now in the middle of a huge rubbish dump made by mankind as a result of 55 years of launching satellites into space somewhat indiscriminately, not bothering what happens to a satellite after it's ceased being useful, and accompanied with lots of other rubbish, including spent rockets, nose cones, nuts and bolts, flakes of paint. Currently, there are about 17,000 objects in orbit, about 10 centimetres or larger, but an estimated 150 million, larger than 0.1 centimetre. Okay, 0.1 centimetre doesn't sound too bad, but don't forget this is travelling at a speed of 10 to 13, 14 kilometres per second. If it hits you, it will go through you. It's also said that approximately 30,000 objects per day come within 10 kilometres of one another. And that, of course, is the known objects. The chance of collision is now said to be 1 in 250. So if there are 1,000 operational satellites, chances are that 4 or 5 will be damaged by one of these objects colliding with it. It might be just a minor collision, a glancing blow, or could be a or a head-on.
Is that in a year or what?
I'm not too sure. They just said a chance of collision 1 in 250. I think it's per year. And looking at the statistics, this is the sort of number of failures we're currently having. What goes up doesn't necessarily come down. This is an interesting graph which shows why the situation we now have has come about. There was this first one where China deliberately shot down one of its own satellites as I reckon, were the most irresponsible action that could be taken. It has destroyed or removed the possibility of certain orbits being used for thousands of years to come. Then we have the incident of USA 193, classified military payload, which failed within a few hours of being launched because the onboard computer did not boot up. We were tracking this, and we detected this. We followed the thing the entire life cycle, and just before it was due to re-entry, the United States deliberately shot it down to ensure that it would not land on undesired territory. The excuse they given was that it carried hazardous propellant on board, which was to be used to carry out orbit maneuvers while during active life. But the real reason was that the payload was extremely sensitive. Then we have the Iridium Cosmos collision, where Iridium 33, an active satellite, collided with a defunct Cosmos satellite. This has produced, so far, 37% of the debris currently in orbit. And that's just from two collisions. But it has produced three clouds of particles that have effectively wiped out several orbits, basically around 750 to 800 kilometres high and around about 1400 to 1450 kilometres. So we now have a real problem up there in space. Kessler, a NASA scientist, in 1978 predicted this was going to happen. A debris flux will increase exponentially with time, even if zero net input rate may be maintained. In other words, when one fragment hits another, it will produce more than one fragment. Those fragments then produce or impact on further fragments, and we get an exponential rate. Some fear we have already passed the point of no return, and that within the next 2 to 3 decades, man will not be able to venture into space because we are surrounded by this debris. So you'll see that the current trend in astronautics is everybody's trying to work out some way that we can get this debris back to ground. I reckon they should get the people that go around pushing these trolleys and collecting all our junk to go up there and get all that junk. There's plenty of precious metals up there. Okay, so who keeps track of this junk? The United States Space Surveillance Network, SpaceTrack, only issue data on non-classified satellites. They are a military organization, and they will not make data available to the general public on missions they consider sensitive. Anybody can get this data after you've registered. I don't know if there's any problems with registration. I'm certainly registered. They know who I am. So they haven't banned me. But whether they will allow countries, shall we say, that America doesn't like, I don't know. Then we have the Russian space surveillance system. Again, it's military, but Russia is limited to only able to track satellites over their location. They don't have tracking stations in the United States, for example. So they only cover 75% of what's in orbit, and the data is not in the public domain. Then we have ISON, the International Scientific Optical Network, run by the Keldysh Institute of Applied Mathematics, Russian Academy of Sciences in Russia. They only track objects in geosynchronous orbit. The data is not in the public domain. But once a year, the European Space Agency publishes a publication called Classification of Geosynchronous Objects. And in that, ISON gives the orbital data for all the satellites they track, with epoch January 1st for that year. That data is obtained from amateurs as well as their network. So from this, you'll see that, gather that ISON and the amateur network have a lot in common. In fact, I was tracking for ISON before it became ISON. But this, I'm jumping ahead. This is the ISON Scientific Optical Network. As you can see, it's comprised basically over Russian territory. There's one station in the United States, New Mexico. It's a remote facility operated by Leonard Ellenen. Some of you may have heard of Comet Ellenen, which a lot of bull was published by the common press that this was this so-called planet that's going to collide with the Earth and all that. Well, an absolute lot of rubbish. And more interesting is that the ISON network has just discovered another comet that in about a year's time is going to be one of the, is predicted to be one of the most spectacular comets that we've ever seen. But we live in the southern hemisphere. We're not favorably placed just yet. It's predicted, I think, to reach magnitude minus 18. But as I say, we're not well positioned to see it. There is one comet that is going to brighten to about fifth magnitude around about March. A thing to note about this is there are no stations in Africa, no stations here. So in the meantime, I cover Southern Africa. Now the ISO network, they are paid. I'm an amateur, I'm not paid. And the amateurs basically include myself and a chap in England, because we cover this part of the geostationary orbit where most of the classified satellites are that belong to the United States. They are monitoring Russia and all the trouble spots in this part of the world. So my observations play a major role, especially if any of their stations are clouded out, which apparently happens quite often. They also like to find any sort of semi-abandoned telescope, recommission it for satellite use, satellite tracking. They're also involved in geostationary NGOs, Near Earth Objects, NEOs. Okay, this is some of the telescopes that they have. As you can see, typical amateurs, some of them typical amateur stuff. I haven't shown their real fancy stuff, but this is the sort of stuff that they use. And they all have basically the same camera. A bit more about that later. These are scattered around. I'll hope to say a little bit more just now. Then the other countries, there are several other countries that operate tracking radars, and include the United Kingdom, France, Germany, and Norway. None of them place their data in the public domain. Okay, the amateur community. Well, we started off well with the IGY, Moonwatch. The amateurs played a major role in the early years of the space age. But Moonwatch closed down in 1975. But there were amateurs who still wanted to track satellites for pleasure. In the mid-1980s, the United States ceased issuing data on what they considered sensitive satellites. This was a challenge the amateurs could not ignore. And that is what started off as tracking and finding these objects. Fortunately, since then, we have acquired some respectability. And this is what is said by Brian Whelan of the Secure Space World Foundation. At one time, he worked for NORAD. Although they are only loosely organized through the internet, they represent a non-trivial SSA capability, space situation awareness. In other words, people being aware of what is in orbit and where it is. Some have the capability to image satellites or detect radio frequency transmissions. In particular, they have demonstrated the ability to routinely track classified national security payloads from several countries. That's not me, I quoted him. ISON, another quote. ISON is a non-government organization, and they come up with some of the most interesting stuff. ISON does not, as far as anyone knows, withhold data because of any national security concerns. They're interested in what the Americans do. This is fairly certain because ISON work is monitored and complemented by the efforts of amateur astronomers and orbital addicts who connect via the internet and constantly scour the sky for new objects and movement of existing ones. They are often the first to spot new objects, mainly because they have more eyeballs, which is not really true, and in some cases, impressive optical equipment searching the skies. The satellite scorecard. As of 26 September, there's 38,780 objects have been orbited, of which only 16,761 still are in orbit, the rest having been deorbited, burnt up, or become classified. After you remove the obvious debris, one ends with 6,615 objects. Again, this does not include classified objects. The amateur network is currently tracking 350 objects not found in the spacecraft catalogue. So that catalogue is missing 20% of the objects, large enough to cause serious damage. For satellite operators, this is a major concern. If they do not know where other satellites are, they cannot take evasive action with their operational satellites. So their operational satellites are flying blind in space, like driving a car with your windows all blacked out. You don't know. You know where you are because you've got GPS, but you don't know where anybody else is. The amateur network is the only organisation that makes these elements freely available to anyone throughout the year. And so that's why they call us a non-trivial capability. The amateur network consists of, well, that's it, there are 22 optical observers, 8 radio observers, some serving in both capacities. Of those 22 optical observers, about 6 of them account for 80% of the observations. In the United States, we have 7 people. Canada, 3. UK, 6. France, 2. Netherlands, 2. Italy, 1. Russia, 2. Sweden, 2. South Africa, 1. I do both optical and radio. Australia, 1 optical, no radio. He observes very infrequently. Now, some of these people occupy professional positions in space organizations, so they like to keep a low profile. So you won't find much mention about what they're doing. For example, one chap, a recent chap that just joined, really playing a major role, he happens to be a radio astronomer at Federal Bank. And he's already done major changes. Another chap in Italy, he's a captain of a cruise liner. Sweden, one of the chaps there is in the Swedish Space Corporation. South Africa, well, I'm just retired. Russia, Netherlands, he is in one of the universities there, he's an archaeologist. UK, mostly retired, one having worked at one of the observatories in Scotland, Edinburgh, and probably one of the best known observers, Russell Herbst. Chap in Canada, I'll come back to them. And then, of course, a couple in the United States, one or two are professors of mathematics at university. We do have rocket scientists. That's why I say the average person wanting to track a satellite doesn't have to worry about that. We leave it to the experts. And when we can't manage, we have software that will do what we need. We maintain a file called Classified TLE, Classified Orbital Elements, orbits for 350 objects, of which about 200 objects are in high orbit, some as high as 50,000 kilometers, that should be actually 100,000. And at least 60 of these satellites are still operational. In addition, it has 85 rocket casings and 25 objects that we have not yet been able to identify with a particular launch. The remaining 150 satellites are in relatively low orbit and include all manner of objects. It is not known how many of these are still operational, apart from those that change their orbits from time to time. It is necessary to track all these satellites frequently in order to detect any orbit changes as early as possible. The longer you take to detect the change, the more difficult it is to find it. But we'll find it. Now, show our collaboration with ASSA. That is Vladimir Agapov, who is in charge of the optical side at ASSA. This here is a gentleman you often find in the press, but you won't find a picture of him. He's going to kill me because I showed this picture. That's Ted Maltzan, Canada. Possibly would be classed as a geek, but he is an expert in orbital mechanics. By profession, he's an environmental engineer running his own consulting business in Toronto, Canada. And he often appears in the press, in the aerospace press, highly respected by the professionals. In last year during the IAF Federation, I was visited by two of my colleagues from ISON. Igor Molotov, by profession, who was originally a radio astronomer and is now the coordinator for the ISON network, and Vladimir Kaplyanov, who writes most of their software based Polkova Observatory in the astrometry department. Anyway, they came to visit me and spent about 7-8 hours at my house. My wife burnt the food that we gave them, but anyway, they ate it. And they watched me track for several hours. And then at the end of it, they said they were going to send me a present. Not, they didn't say what it was, and I thought maybe I misunderstood because there was a communication gap in it. Because Igor could hardly speak English, while Vladimir's English wasn't too bad. But I thought, oh, I'm hearing wrong. But a few months later, I got a big package, that size. Free of charge, gift, no strings attached. Come to more about that just now. This has changed my tracking attitude and what I track. In return for what I consider a fantastic gift, I feel I owe them something. I guess you were using psychology in me. Okay, this is sort of typical installation. This is a setup used by one of our Russian, American chaps. He, by profession, why? To show that we're not anti-patriotic. He is an American. His son serves in Afghanistan. He served on one of the US aircraft carriers as a fighter jet pilot. He retired from the Air Force, became a professor of mathematics, and is now retired. But unfortunately, since he's retired, he's too busy flying aircraft all over the country. He's now ferrying aircraft all over the place. So he's not very active. But he was doing something that I'm not at liberty to divulge, because we don't want the wrong people to hear about it. Not everything we do is in the public domain. There's another chap, Derek Bright, in California, basically interested in occultations. Okay, he's got a nice big telescope, but he doesn't use it. That's his satellite tracking gear. An 80mm finder with a little video camera attached to it. He's not particularly active, but he filled a useful gap in that he's one of the few observers that we have on the western coast of the United States. Most of the observers in the United States are all situated in Texas for some strange reason. The rest of the United States aren't aware of what's going on. We have one chap who's a bluesman in the United States Coastal Guard. Now, this is a chap you'll find quite often in the press, Kevin Fetter. He lives in Canada. His profession is a petrol station attendant. So that shows you don't need a rocket scientist. But he is probably, he admits he's the biggest geek of the lot. He lives for only one thing, and that's looking at satellites. So he likes working as a petrol station attendant because he sets up his telescope at night to operate remotely, goes and sells petrol, and when he comes home at during the day, he goes for what he's found. So he spends a lot of time observing the sky, picks up all sorts of manner of objects. But as I say, he's not married, he lives with his mother, he has only one interest, and there's a telescope, nothing fancy. That's my setup, some of them, including a Celestron, 6-inch. Ian's got an identical one, which I purchased second-hand for 3,000 Rand. From one of the ladies of the Astronomical Society, she'd been trying to sell it for years. Nobody was interested. She had two telescopes, one that belonged to her, and one belonged to her husband. Her husband died, she lost interest, these telescopes were for sale. I got one, Ian got the other one. And he got his 500 Rand cheaper than me. But mine was slightly better condition. Okay, there's my free gift I got, a CCD camera. I'll show a little bit more just now. How much for time?
Just over 5 minutes.
Well, go. Okay, so that's some of my setups. That's another setup, that's my control center for optical. I'm running 5 computers to operate my system. Most of them are old computers, some of them are even running DOS. That's my radio setup. I won't go into that now. I don't do radio astronomy because I have continuous coverage up to 3,000 megahertz and intermittent coverage up to the KU band. But this is for tracking classified satellites only. Some of the cameras I use, video camera, well-known video camera, and the ME CCD camera, which was the camera I used before I got this fancy one. 3,326 by 2,504. Large image size, a large pixel area, small pixel size. Very nice. Okay, I went through that. That just described the typical observing session. I haven't got time to go into that. But I normally take 1,200 to 2,000 images a session, which may last 4 to 6 hours, depending on the weather. I image down to magnitude 15 or 16. Exposure is typically seldom longer than 10, 15 seconds, purely because I live in a light-polluted area. I cannot go longer. I am limited by my sky. There is no image processing done whatsoever. The whole idea is to get an image that has a satellite on it. As long as I can see the satellite and I've got 2 or 3 reference stars, that's enough. I get from that, I do determine the astrometric position to an accuracy or sub-arc-second accuracy or sub-pixel accuracy and timing accuracy better than 50 milliseconds, controlled by GPS, courtesy of what they Iceland sent me. Okay. Well, those are some of the activities I carried. Probably the most interesting one was EgyptSat. Then they approached me via a space corporation. Could I observe this thing to see if it was where NASA said it was? And if it was there, what was the optical behavior? I was able to confirm that it was where the United States said it was, and that it was tumbling. Okay, what next? We've got to expand. We have to expand, especially in the southern hemisphere. I'm getting old, I'm getting more lazy, getting fatter. We cannot cope with the number of satellites in the list. So many are observed infrequently and sometimes lost until found again. For example, the OPEC satellites launched by Israel. New good observers are rare, and many don't stay the course. We now want to go in for all-night automatic tracking. Practical, but how does one cope with the data? Someone has to sit down the next day and go through 7, 8, 9 hours of images. It's been suggested to me that I go live streaming on, say, Google+, so that anyone in the world can see what I'm doing in real time. But it's not practical, as my internet connection, courtesy of Telcom, is far too slow and cannot handle the data rates required. So I cannot stream what I do over the internet. So this is also a hobby. There is no money, and especially no time for those still trying to earn a living. That's an image of the OPEC satellite, OPEC 9, taken by me. 1 second exposure. This is a three second exposure taken from my backyard. I can't see the Milky Way from where I am, but it shows up in a camera. 7.6 by 5.7 degree field, 3 second exposure, camera stationary. So the satellite over there is a short trail. That over there, that's measure 7. It's a 135mm focal length camera, f2.8. There's the camera size, okay. 4-bin mode. Some other images, geostationary. These are all around about 12 magnitude. ASSA group of satellites, commercial group. The last one launched by the United States. Top secret, but we're tracking it. The next one scheduled is October the 25th. When this one goes up again, I'm going to be busy again having to find it. But this one's easy. It's big, it's naked eye. Okay, thank you.
Absolutely fascinating stuff. Thank you very much, Greg.
Okay.
One or two questions. Greg, you mentioned there was an Iridium Cosmos collision.
Yes.
That sort of renders that orbit reasonably unusable.
Practically.
The rest of the Iridium satellites
that are... Well, they've got to face the possibility of collisions.
So nobody would put something else there?
They got to maintain the constellation. So the problem with the collision is that we only are aware of when they collide with an active payload, when suddenly that payload disappears. For example, Sunset, the one launched by South Africa, that was knocked out by debris. The Inversat satellite, which was the flagship of the European Space Agency, was destroyed by collision a few months ago. It's happening all the time. The United States themselves lost one of their major payloads, DSP 23. This is now drifting along the geostationary belt and presenting a danger to any satellite that happens to lie along the same path in the sky, along the geostationary clock belt. So, I reckon the situation is out of control.
Ian, you had a question?
Yeah, I heard a rumor once, and I'd like to know if it's true or not, that you were once described as an enemy of the United States in the Senate.
Yes, there is it can be found on the internet. Well, it wasn't me specifically, but by inference, because they describe what they call NGOs, non-government observers. And they present a threat to the security of the United States, and they said there's observers, and in South Africa was mentioned. I'm the only South African observer, and I also happen to be the most active one. And probably the biggest pain in there.
Thank you very much, Greg. And there's a small token.